15, verse 51. Paul is prophesying a couple thousand years ago about an event that is imminent. An event that is imminent. We would know it as the rapture of the church. In 1 Corinthians 15, reading from verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. I heard Brother Huntley say one time that he has that scripture over top of the nursery at his church. All them babies might not sleep, but they're going to change them all, so that's a good thing. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Sting of death is sin. The strength of the sin is the law. But thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And Paul said this mystery will be revealed of the rapture of the church. Mortal putting on immortality, corruption putting on incorruption. And he reaches back to Isaiah's prophecy and says that the prophecy will be fulfilled, which declared death is swallowed up in victory. But this fulfillment that will happen in the rapture of the church when we're changed is something that is ever present, the principle of this, ever present in the Christian walk. And so I've come to preach that death is swallowed up in victory. Why don't one more time we clap our hands and let the Lord know that we are ready for His word. We're ready, God. We're ready, God. Our heart is open. Our spirit is open. Our faith is high to receive Your word. I feel faith trying to rise up in the place. Why don't we clap our hands again? I feel a spirit of faith trying to move across our beings and lift us up. Thank You, Jesus. Amen, amen. God bless you. You may be seated. I am going to be making a lot of personal reference today to try to give you personal experience of where I have been and where I feel so strongly, and I have received the prophetic word of where I am trying to walk in humbleness and trembling before God in ministry. But twice in our ministry, I have been privileged to see this death swallowed up in victory, literally in the physical realm. Twice I have seen in our ministry the dead raised to life. It's interesting to me, I don't know what it says about the state, but both of these were in the state of Tennessee. I don't know, I'm just stating a fact. Twice I've seen the dead raised, and of all the places I've been, Tennessee is where I saw it both times. The first time was in Central Tennessee, and Pastor Don McCool was the pastor. And we had been preaching revival service, and we were in the altar, and it was a time of the pastor giving his last benediction, his blessing, and we were getting prepared to leave the service. And as I was standing there, having ministered and given myself, there was a lady that was, I could almost reach her if I had leaned forward. She was standing just a couple of feet in front of me. And as he is speaking, the pastor is loving the people. She crumples down to the ground. And it took us just a few moments to realize what was going on. You know, sometimes people are yielding or worshiping or whatever, and they might fall to the ground. So we waited a few minutes as she's laying there. But the position that she is in looks quite uncomfortable and unnatural. And so someone, after just a minute or two, kneels beside her and begins to realize that she's not praying. She's not worshiping. Matter of fact, she's not breathing. And when they found that out, they began to roll her over, and they're trying to do everything in their limited knowledge that they can do. They began to reach out to different ones and say, hey, she's not breathing. Something's wrong. Someone ran to call 911, and there's a lot of scurrying around. A nurse in the place is trying to be fetched. I think she was back in the nursery, and all these things are happening. And in the midst of that, I felt a prompting of the Holy Ghost. And as Pastor was coming down to pray, I asked if I could pray a prayer of resurrection. And he said, by all means. We laid a hand on her head by the authority of the Word of God, by the power of the name of Jesus Christ. Arise. And instantly, this elder regained life. Her breath came back. Her heartbeat came back. And God raised her up. Just a couple of minutes. God be the glory. Just a couple of minutes later, the medical team comes running in with a stretcher and all of their different paraphernalia of medical ability. And they ran into the church and they said, where's the one that has fallen down dead? And we said, well, she's over there in the back corner jumping and worshiping and praising God. That took a little while for them to try to grasp what was going on. They talked her into going to the hospital to run tests and exam. It's a testimony to how God does the miraculous when they could find no damage to her heart, no damage to her brain, that God had healed and raised her up and made her whole, whole. Similar, very similar type of situation. And the second time I saw God raise someone from the dead in our ministry, we were in Western Tennessee at this time, and the power of God had moved, and faith had operated in the church service that day, and many miracles had happened. And Pastor and I are still in the altar ministering to different ones, and there is an elderly lady that is sitting maybe six or seven rows back in the middle section to the right, and she has turned to her husband, and she said, honey, I'm tired. Why don't we just go on home? And he hugged her a little bit and said, I know you're tired, but it feels so good to linger in the presence of God. Anybody know what I'm talking about? It feels so good to just linger a little while in the presence of God. I would even encourage you that so many more miracles happen in that time when we're not in a big hurry to go find out what the score is, when we're not in a big hurry to go about the business of preparing for tomorrow, but we just linger in the presence of God. There's something special that happens. And so she said, okay, I will stay a little longer. But just a few moments after doing that, her head fell back on the pew with a resounding knock. Her eyes had rolled back in her head. Her breath was gone from her. There was no heartbeat. After a few frantic moments of him, her husband, trying to find out what the problem was with her, he got someone's attention to go get his son-in-law, who was a medical profession of some type, and this son-in-law came over and began with all of his expertise to try to find a heartbeat, to try to find a breath, but no beat or pulse in the neck, nothing upon the wrist. There was no life within her. Someone came running to the front where Pastor and I were ministering to different ones, and they were a little frantic and said, you got to come back. And they turned and left. And we're thinking, we'll get there, but we're ministering here. We're doing something here. Why should we just leave in the middle of what's happening here? Didn't realize exactly what was going on. And a couple of minutes after that, finally someone came and pulled us away and got our attention and said, Sister Kitchen is dead. You've got to come back. Realizing what the situation was now, we went back to where she was. There was a battle that had come across the church. You could feel a spirit of panic. You could feel a fear that the people of God were battling. And even in some, a hopelessness. What are we going to do? There was crying you could begin to hear. Tears running down their face. Understand, Sister Kitchen was beloved. Many were related to her. It was their aunt. It was their sister. It was their friend. She even had children in the house that night. And they are hurting, grieving, but also they are battling fear. They're battling panic. They're battling hopelessness. And when we got back to where she was, the pastor had great wisdom. He got everybody's attention. He said, wait a minute. This has been an operation of faith from the entire beginning of the service until now. And this miracle has happened. And that miracle has happened. And faith has been operating. He said, I believe that God just wants to show himself powerful. He said, would you rebuke fear and panic and hopelessness and begin to let faith operate in you and believe that just perhaps God wants to do a miracle. The church caught a hold of his direction. They began to lift their voice and rebuke the spirit of fear and rebuke panic and rebuke the spirit of hopelessness. And as they rebuked fear, you could feel faith beginning to rise within the congregation. And little by little, some began to clap their hands. Some were jumping up and down. She's dead. And they're jumping up and down and clapping their hands and thanking God that he is a miracle worker. But when faith got high, regardless of what they saw, then the operation of the miraculous began to happen. We laid hands on her head and spoke a simple prayer. By the authority of the word of God, the power of the name of Jesus, Sister Kitchen, arise. And instantly her head came forward. Her eyes rolled back where they were supposed to be. She started breathing again. And she looked around kind of quietly and said, oh my, how come everybody's looking at me? I began to see in just these two instances that this battle is not the battle versus life or death, but the battle is that fear concerning life and death. It's the panic. It is the hopelessness that comes upon us. The scripture begins to tell us very clearly. Hebrews 9:27 declares, it's appointed unto man once to die, but after that, the judgment. We all know that everyone that breathes, should the Lord tarry, will one day quit breathing. All that is life will one day go on to our eternity. Psalms 90:10 tells us, the days of our years are 70, and if by reason of strength they be 80 years, that God has average promised us around 70 years, give or take, because of physical or spiritual or some kind of strength. And if you have strength, perhaps as much as 80, a few years more, or perhaps a few years less. Ecclesiastes confirms to us that there is a time for everything, a time to live, and then there is a time to die, and the time and circumstance happen to us all. But sometimes we as Christians, we as apostolics, lose the proper perspective that God has concerning the death of flesh. For he tells us this in Psalms 116:15, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. I had the tremendous privilege in my home church at Atlanta West to be able to go to the celebration service of a death of one of our great elders. Sister Floyd had passed away, and her husband came there with a heavy heart, grieving. Many, many family members there, several of them, pastors and preachers and ministers' wives, etc. And they gathered in that room, and there was a heavy heart because of missing their mama, missing their grandma, missing their friend, and knowing that in this life they would not see her again. Grief should be there. But there was a celebration that began to sweep from one side of that building to the other as we looked at her life that had been living before God with faithfulness, a life that had believed in God, a life that had been a testimony to her children and to her grandchildren, to neighbors and to friends. And we celebrated her homecoming. It was a precious thing. Sometimes we let fear, the battle of fear and the battle of panic and the battle of hopelessness steal the victory that God would want to bring to us as there is a death of a saint. But not even all sicknesses are unto death. Not all sicknesses are unto death. And not all deaths are complete and final. But it is the purpose. It is within the kingdom of God that we see the resurrection and the life. We see it so many times in the spiritual realm as we watch people who are dead in their spiritual life walk down to an altar, and there they repent of their sins. There they make the commitment to be baptized in the lovely name of Jesus, washing away their sins. And we watch life come to people as they receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, evidence of speaking in tongues. And indeed, it is the greatest life that you can have, both in this world and in the world to come. But sometimes we think that the only value and miracle and strength we have is this spiritual life of the infant of the Holy Ghost, when God has made it so plain and clear that He wants to show us death can be swallowed up in victory, and that death has no sting, fulfilled in the rapture when we are changed from corruption to incorruption, immortal to immortality. But every place that we see, this should be fulfilled in our life. Our joy should know that there's a time of resurrection no matter what has killed our joy. Our peace should know that there's a time of resurrection no matter what storm we have gone through. And no matter how bad the battle has been, we should know that there's a God that can speak into the ink blackness of death in our life and declare life. Not just our emotions and our spirit, but literally a physical resurrection. I have yet to have anyone volunteer that they want the miracle of resurrection happen in their life. I guess you have to die first before you. No one seemingly is volunteering for that miracle. But I see this principle everywhere in the scripture. It's the prophet Elisha that's speaking to the Shunammite woman and declaring to her that the promised son is not dead, final. But going into the room, he begins to let the Spirit lead him. And before he comes out of the room, the child, the son, the boy is resurrected. There are resurrections within the Old Testament. Hezekiah has heard the prophetic word, and understand, he is sick unto death. He has a sickness upon his physical body, and the prophet has spoken, you're not going to get better. It's time to get your house in order. This sickness is unto death. But there is yet a resurrection opportunity. And so Hezekiah turns his face to the wall and begins to pray a prayer of faith. And ultimately he comes to the decision that the dead cannot praise you, God. So if you raise me up, I will commit my life to give you praise. I will be a worshiper. I will be a praiser. And he reached to a psalm and declared that the living will praise you. So let me live so that I can sing your praises. God turns the prophet back around, and it's resurrection that is spoken. That this sickness that was unto death will now not take his life, but he will have 15 more years. Within the New Testament, we see this perhaps even more powerfully demonstrated as Jesus many times begins to show resurrection power. He stops the widow's funeral procession of her only son and raises the son up, and raises not only the physical life of a son, but the emotional and spiritual life of a mama when that son is once again breathing and his heart is beating. We see him speaking to Lazarus and declaring, come forth. And even though a body that has begun to decay, been in the grave 4 days and is stinking from the decaying process, now is somehow made whole by the power of resurrection and comes to life because of the resurrecting power of Christ. No greater example than Calvary itself. When death and the grave had held him for 3 days and now the stone is rolled away, death has no victory. Grave has no sting because of the resurrection power of Christ. But it goes further than that. Even his disciples operate in resurrection power. The Apostle Paul was preaching one day, and it's my assumption that he was perhaps being a little long-winded. Because as he is preaching, there is a young man in the congregation who's sitting in an open window, and he is becoming weary, tired, sleepy. His name is Eutychus. I think I've told you before that Greek name Eutychus means lucky. Lucky is sitting in the window and falls asleep and falls out to his death, whether a broken neck or just exposure to breath. There is no life within him. I guess it was lucky in that there were people of faith and people of resurrection. And so Paul begins to pray the prayer of resurrection. And lucky is resurrected to life. It is involved not only in the life of Christ, but also in his followers. Simon Peter hears of Dorcas, of Tabitha, and how she is passed from this life. And they are telling her all the great things that she has done. I see wisdom in Simon Peter as he goes into the room and kneels to pray. In my imagination, I see that he's finding the will and the purpose of God. Is this death final? Is this sickness final? Or is it something for the glory of God to be made manifest? I hope that when something comes against our life or against our loved ones, some symptom, some sickness, some disease, or even death, that we take the time to fight the battle and don't just give in to fear and don't just give in to panic, but ask the Lord, what's your will here, God? And when I see Simon Peter finding the will of God, then with faith, knowing God's will, he turns and declares, Tabitha, arise. And many days dead, she now is sitting up in bed and breathing. Her heart is beating as God has given her life again. The battle is not with life and death, but the battle so much is that spirit of fear and that panic that comes upon us and that hopelessness that wants to steal from us. I have been in the past several years, two or three in particular, experiencing this battle in ministry and experiencing this in several different dimensions in my own life. In 2005, God opened a door for me to go to the Bible school in South Africa and to minister to young men and women concerning evangelism. At the time, the church in South Africa, almost 50 years of age, well established, had no full-time evangelism program at that time. And so we went in to try to build trust in the pastors and try to encourage and give instruction to the young men and young women who were hungry for that type of ministry. And as we are there teaching in the Bible school, God begins to do great miracles. And there's a pastor in the city of, just outside of Pretoria, in the city of Esterus, that is a powerful man of God. His name is Oliphant. Pastor Oliphant hears of what's happening in the Bible school and invites me to come preach in his church. It's the first church that I would preach in the nation of South Africa. And when I was there preaching, the Holy Ghost began to move and a liberty for gifts of the Spirit. I turned to speak a prophetic word to the man on the keyboard that God was not going to let him out of a calling that he had given himself to the music of ministry, but God was going to resurrect that ministry of exhortation that he needed to stand behind a pulpit. And after I ministered to him, I turned to another. Did not know till after church that was Brother Oliphant's son. As I spoke to a lady over here, the next one I spoke to, I found out after service that was Pastor Oliphant's daughter. The next person that I spoke to was in the back over here. Did not know until afterwards, Pastor Oliphant's wife. There were seven people that were spoken to from that pulpit. Every one of them were his relatives. The next one was a young lady that was standing in the door, out of the door. She had a baby on her hip, and she was trying not to be a disturbance and going out, but wanting to come back in for what was happening in the church service. And one of the times she poked her head back in, the Holy Ghost prompted me. I spoke to his niece, Pastor Oliphant. His name means elephant. He's about 5 foot, maybe 1 inch. And when I stood beside him for them to take our picture, I felt like an elephant. God bless you, Brother Oliphant. But he was a giant in the spirit and powerful in faith. Tremendous man of God and a pillar of the church in South Africa. And so God began to connect us spiritually, a strong connection to Pastor, to his family, and to that church in Esdras. We were there some 29 days in the region of South Africa as well as Lesotho with Brother Klein, and great miracles happened. But God began to open a door, and from 2005, I have been to South Africa in particular and other African nations every year, sometimes once, sometimes twice a year. So I've been to Lesotho, Namibia, Madagascar, Uganda, Kenya, Botswana, and other countries in the continent of Africa, but almost every year to South Africa. And this church, Esther's church, has been a church that has opened up their hearts and their spirits to us many times, and God has done great things. We, my wife and I, had decided, as God was leading us, that we didn't need to just continue these trips by ourselves. But there was a burden in our heart to have a mentoring-type crusade conference that we felt to take hyphen age individuals from North America, both male and female, that were single, and take them over to South Africa, and they would pray when I was praying, and they would be there in ministering the services, and I would talk to them about what happened in the altar service and what I was feeling, what I was seeing, and I'd minister to them as the Holy Ghost would lead in the crusade. There were great things that would happen, and we put together our first team. And this was in December of 2012. I want to give you a timeline so you can see how specific this spiritual battle is. In December of 2012, we are putting together the first team. We are scheduled to go to the church at Esdras as well as many other areas. And we get the news that a prominent member of that church, his wife has passed away. Blessed saint. She is a young lady. She has two children. One is 8 or 9 years old, a daughter, and the son is 5 years old. And they began to tell us how the church is confused, how the church is battling a spirit of fear because the death was so sudden, so unexpected, and unexplainable by all of the medical professionals. And they do not know what is going on. They began to confess to us, "We need you here. Make sure your team is prepared. God is going to do something. He's going to break the back of the enemy. We know that great things are going to happen, and that spiritual battle of fear, panic, hopelessness is going to be defeated. We are preparing to go. Our team is all ready." And just a few short days, 6 months later from her death, the son that lost his mother, Ethan, that five-year-old, has a mysterious, what they called a freak medical accident. And Ethan later is diagnosed with acute encephalitis. And he is in the hospital in a vegetable state. He cannot open his eyes. He cannot talk. He cannot walk. He cannot eat. He is only being sustained by the machines in that hospital room. They have told the father, Ellis, they said, "Ellis, prepare yourself. He will never leave this hospital room. If he somehow does, he will never be normal. He will always be in this state. If somehow you can take him home, you'll have to have machines and stuff constantly keeping his heart beating, keeping his lungs pumping. He will never change." And so now, right before we get there, this is the state of what the church is. First, they lost this precious sister. And now the five-year-old boy of that sister has a medical freak. They do not know how it happened. It's unexplainable, and the church is battling fear. They is battling helplessness. 6 months, two people on the edge. One died and one on the edge of death. And then the day before we get there, Pastor Oliphant passed away. And if the church was confused and hurt, spirit of fear, their leader is taken from them and they do not know what to do. 2013, we arrived there, and the first church service that most of them were in was the crusade, the conference service that we were speaking and ministering to them. And that battle is so strong upon them, of fear, of panic, of hopelessness, confusion. We don't know what to know. We don't know what to believe. We don't have direction, and we're consumed by this fear. We've lost one of our best saints. The child of that saint is in the hospital bed dying. Our pastor is gone from us. What do we do? We had opportunity before that last service to go to the hospital, squeezed a moment of time to be able to pray for that little boy. Walked into that hospital room with great faith, the team with me. I turned to the nurses and said, "We've come to rebuke death, and we have come to speak life." And she said, "Go for it." I love it when the medical profession are believers. I wasn't sure how much she knew. I said, "You know, we're going to lift our voice. It might sound like we're angry. We're not mad at you. We're not mad at the children. We are coming against this battle of hopelessness and fear." And she said, "Lift your voice." She said, "Matter of fact, while you're praying, pray for this one, this one, this one, this one." There were 10 children in the room. It was church. In the hospital room when we began to lift our voice, and Ethan was there being sustained by these machines. Instantly God gave me a word for Ellis about changing something to medicine, and we walked out of that room, seemingly very little change happening. Went to the church service and began to preach a message of life and a message of hope and a message of resurrection. Power of God began to move in that place prophetically. It was spoken that Ethan would get up and would walk. We flew home the next day. 3 weeks later, we got the Facebook message. For the first time, he has opened his eyes and is looking around. About 3 weeks or a month later, we get another message. He's breathing on his own. He's beginning to talk to us. Another 3 weeks or so, we get the word. He set up for the first time. It was exactly 6 months again, and Ethan walked out of that hospital completely whole, completely healed. It is a medical documentary that those in South Africa are amazed by. They have never seen this happen before. God is still in the resurrection business. So now, it's the end of 2013, and they have gone through the process of electing a new pastor. A great man of God, Pastor Nwezi, has been elected to pastor the church there 6 months before we'd come for the next crusade with our team. And 6 months before, he is brought into pastor. And now in June and July, late July, we are planning in 2014 to go back with our team. And just mere days before we would leave, they call us again and say, "Pastor Nwezi's wife has passed away." Mysteriously, unpredictably, and they're not sure why. At the same time, a neighboring church's pastor's wife, also in the same hospital, unexpectedly passed away. "We need you. We felt life. We felt hope. Can you come?" We went that particular year, and I remember meeting Pastor Nwezi grieving. Many again, the first service they were in was the crusade that we were preaching in the Esther's church. And Pastor Nwezi, grieving in his heart, having lost his beloved mere days before, looks at me and just shrugs his shoulders and says, I don't know. I know that this is more than just life and death. This is spiritual. And God is trying to do something, but he said, "Honestly, I'm confused. I hope you have a word for us." Power of God moved tremendously in these services. Life began to come again to their hearts, to their spirits. God began to do great things. As we were leaving, he turned to me and said, "I'll see you next year, but I don't know who's going to die next year. Maybe me," he said. "Maybe some prominent member in the church." And then he said, "I don't know, maybe you." Thanks for that word there, brother. And so we went home. It is now 2015, and the team is together for 2015, this past year. And we are preparing ourselves again to go to South Africa. We had to, because of the tightness of schedule a meeting in Athens, Greece, that we were preaching just mere days before our trip to South Africa. Lois and myself had been 10 days away from home in Greece, and now we're coming back, and it's late at night, but we've been away from the family. Want to kiss them grandbabies, so we tell everybody to meet us at Chili's restaurant. It's 10:30 at night, and we're getting a bite to eat after we fellowship. Jet lag is weighing upon my eyelids, so I said, Lois, I'm going to go get the car. I'll pull it up to the door and pick you up. And absently, tiredly, I walk across the parking lot. I have my keys, my remote in my hand, and open the door. And I stand in the door and hesitate just a moment, stand in the door, tired and not really thinking clearly. And as I'm standing there, a black sedan screeches up behind me, smoke billowing from their tires. They have pinned my car in. Out jumps two very young African-American boys. Now, I only declared this, that they're African-American, so that you would understand there is a specific connection to Africa. And so here they are, these would-be gangsters, these hoodlums with sawed-off shotguns. And they are yelling and screaming and pointing them at me. I'm making a quick diagnosis of my situation. I can't get in the car. There's no escape, no time for me to turn on the car. I'm going to be stuck here. He's have his way. I'm vulnerable. And I thought the only thing I could do is drop to the ground and get the car door that's open between me and that gun. Slithering like a worm underneath the door, I decided to get the entire car length between me and him and crawled around the front of the car and lifted my head cautiously over the hood to see what this was. Is it a real robbery? What is going on? Someone playing a trick? And when I looked over the hood, he's not looking at me, but he sees me in the peripheral and swings his sawed-off shotgun to where I'm at. I'm so close, just the length of a car. I can literally see the muscles in his hand tensing, and I think he's about to pull a trigger. I drop to the ground. I crawl another two cars away and lift my head up, looking through two car windows to see what he's doing. When he realizes that he can't find me and I'm too far away, he drops into the car. He can't steal from me. He can't rob me. He can't bring bodily harm to me. So he jumps in the car, and he's searching for something to steal in the glove compartment. He finds very little between the seat and the console, very little. But there is our suitcases in the back from where we just got from the airport back from Greece, and a backpack that we'd carried on the plane that happens to have checkbook and our passports. We're supposed to go to South Africa in about 10 days. And he grabs the backpack. His friend is hollering, let's go, let's go, let's go. They're screaming, making all kind of noise. As they run to the car, I'm running out from behind the car. I want to at least get a partial license plate so I maybe can help do something to alleviate this lawlessness. And as they speed away, I'm memorizing tag numbers. And a policeman that has been in the Chili's restaurant comes running out. He's an Atlanta policeman, and he is wringing his hands, and he said, I am shocked and surprised not to find someone on the pavement with their life's blood oozing from them. He said, it's not the intention so many times, but when this kind of action happens, he said, if you'd have had a gun and tried to protect yourself, you or one or two of them could easily be dead right now. He said, if somehow in the action, in the fright of what's happening, that individual jerked a little bit, you could have perhaps got the full brunt of that sawed-off shotgun. And we began to even just then realize how close we could have come to death. In fact, there was something that happened to me physically, and I'm not one to seemingly panic. I do well at assessing the situation and stepping back, but I noticed from that day forward at the very base of my fingernails was a vertical line on all, I've got 10 fingers, on all 10 of them, a vertical line. And it began to grow out as time went by and eventually was clipped off at the end of my fingernails. I looked online and just found some kind of homeopathic understanding that when you are in times of tremendous adrenaline and your body is in that fight or flight, that it will actually consume certain minerals in your body and leave you with deficiencies that can be shown. It was that kind of experience. It took about 2 hours to get free from all the reports and the things that needed to happen. On my way home, it's 1 o'clock in the morning, I get a phone call from a pastor in Louisiana. He said, "My wife just had a dream. We were headed to your funeral. You were in a casket. We did not know how you died, something related to travel, all the traveling you do. And we were just coming to pay our respects and to grieve." I said, "Thanks a lot." I didn't say anything to him about what I've been experiencing, what I've been through. I'm trying to find what God's will and God's purpose is in all of this. 2 days later, I got another phone call from another pastor in Louisiana. What's wrong with them Louisiana pastors? And he said, "I had a dream that you were being chased by dark-skinned men, and they chased you down, and they took your life." I said, "Thanks." We talked and prayed, and he got off the phone. And I'm beginning to hear again what Pastor Nwezi said. "Who's going to die this time? Maybe you." And there tries to come a battle of fear and panic and hopelessness. And the enemy speaks to me and says, "You've got the best excuse. You can't get to South Africa. You have no passport. Just call them up and tell them you've had this and there's no way you can get there. And you don't worry about who's going to die this time or whether it's you or the plane is going to go down or you're going to get some kind of sickness or this is going to happen or that's going to..." Just back out of that. But I recognize that spirit of fear that I have dealt with in so many areas and dealt in particular with that church in Esdras. And I rose up with my wife and we rebuked the spirit of fear. We called our team members and said, "Hey, are you ready to go? God is doing great things and they're ready for us." We called South Africa and said, "Things are coming together. God is going to do great things," and never told them what we had been through. We have faith believing that somehow God is going to give us favor. There's no way that the government can turn around and produce a passport in that short amount of time. But we are praying and believing. 2 days before we would leave, we got a phone call from Atlanta police and said, "We have recovered your backpack. We see your passports are in it. Your checkbook is still in it." A different vehicle, a different part of Atlanta, totally different, but they recovered our backpack. I am recalling, as I am going through this, a spiritual principle that I have been preaching all across our globe about overcoming that brings spiritual authority in your life. That when Jesus was led of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted, he came out after the temptation, not given in to the temptation. He came out with great authority and great power. And instantly he delivered the demoniac and the sick and healed those that were diseased and began to operate in power. That this was an opportunity of spiritual authority, not to give in to panic, not to give in to fear, to rebuke it in Jesus' name and go with faith. We got on the plane, flew to South Africa. I think I slept half the way. I was tired. Wasn't worried about a plane going down. Team did not know what we had been through. But when we stood in the pulpit, something broke in that service. You could hear a sound as of a rushing mighty wind that began to flow. There were two individuals in the place that were dealing with HIV or perhaps the AIDS virus that God began to heal and do a miracle. There were those that were facing intimate death that God began to heal and do a great miracle. It wasn't so much the battle of life and death, but it's the overcoming of the spirit of fear and the spirit of hopelessness. Spirit of panic. And I know in the Holy Ghost that I have been sent to pray a prayer over this congregation. and declaring to you that you will not die, but you shall live, and you shall show forth the praises of him that has brought you out of darkness. This church will not die. The vision will not die. The revival will not die. But there is a resurrection, and there is a power that is upon you. Would you lift your voice and receive God's word to us? Go ahead and stand with me. Go ahead and stand with me. There are many. Matter of fact, let's do it this way. There are many in this place that have dealt with some physical symptom in your body, whether it was a chest pain or migraine headache or something else. You dealt with a physical pain in your body in just the past few weeks, and instantly that battle that I've been preaching about came against you, and the enemy said, you about to die. This pain is a heart attack. This pain is a stroke. This pain is this. This pain is that. And they've got all this battle that has come against you. If I'm talking about you, would you lift your hands with me? I'm confessing there has been some chest pains that I have experienced. They're not upon me now, but in the last few weeks I've experienced. Let me see your hand high. Don't be afraid to let the church see where some of the battle has been across this beautiful congregation of people. I want to rebuke the spirit of fear that is trying to steal from you what God's purpose and direction is. Many times God is just trying to show himself powerful. He's trying to stretch your faith to a new dimension. But if that fear steals your faith, then you can't operate in the purpose and the will of God. Can I even say this? How many of you have had the enemy tell you that the revival will no longer happen at NAC? How many of you that the enemy has come and said, because of what has happened, a wound that has happened to you, that no longer will you have the promises that have been prophesied? No longer will you walk in what God has declared. How many of you have had to fight that little battle of panic and fear and hopelessness? It's a battle. And if we give in to that, then we lose the victory that God wants to bring. He is the resurrection, and he is the life. And he wants to speak healing to our physical bodies and healing to our spirits and emotions. If you need a touch in your physical body right now, and in particular, you have battled this battle of fear and hopelessness and doubt the enemy has tried to put you under, I want you to lift both your hands right now as we begin to speak against this. Fear, I come against you by the authority of the word of God. Hopelessness, I speak to you in the name of Jesus. Panic, you must hear the words that are being prayed now in the name of Jesus. You have no hold over the Christian. You have no hold over the Holy Ghost field. Get out of our minds, get out of our hearts, get out of our spirits. I rebuke you in Jesus' name. So that faith would arise even now by the authority of the word of God and the power of the name of Jesus Christ. Whew. Now would you let a shout of triumph begin to move across our congregation? Yes! Yes! Now reach out, believer. Now reach out, believer, and lay hands on the shoulder of a believer beside you and begin to pray the prayer that believers pray, that we rebuke sickness and disease by the authority of the word of God, and we declare healing virtue. Healing virtue. Symptoms are gone. Sickness gone. Disease gone. Woo! You shall live. You shall live. You shall live. Would you join me in the altar? Everybody just come on down the altar if you would join us. Sister Cook, where you at, Mama? I know that you will let me speak this, and I know that you can receive it, and Pastor can straighten me out. But I believe what you have gone through was a sickness unto death. But there's a resurrection that is upon you. And so death has not succumbed. You've not succumbed to death. But mostly you've not succumbed to fear and to panic and to hopelessness. And that battle has been won by you for the sake of you to pray the prayer that you're praying and to speak healing and wholeness and resurrection. Speak life. Sister Cook, speak life right now. Speak life into revival. Speak life into your brothers and sisters. Speak life. Woo! What the enemy meant to destroy you, God will turn to good. And I see even more prominent the prophecy that God is lifting Nack up and putting you on a hill so that you can be a light that will be seen to this community. You'll be more prominent in this community. They will know who you are, not only by your name, but by the power of God that operates within you and the authority that you walk in. I speak life. Woo! Can I tell you how strongly I feel this? That if somehow I was to fall dead right now while I'm here preaching, I believe that there's a resurrection prayer that would be prayed and I would somehow get back to my feet and preach again the word of God. There is a resurrection power in this place. Timing. And knowing the will of God concerning timing is so important. A sensitivity that we must have concerning what God's purpose is, what God's will is, what His timing is. But His prophecies are yea and amen. And I've come to declare unto you that He is speaking life and that you shall live. You shall live and not die. You shall declare the works of God and not die. You shall live and declare the power of God. Whew. I need to give an opportunity while faith is so high. If in your spiritual life today you found a deadness, if you need a life in your spirit, would you with all of the saints of God lift up your hand right now? I'm going to pray for the Holy Ghost to come across this congregation and life abundant to be upon you. I pray for the Holy Ghost to fall and let the life of the Spirit operate in every hungry spirit and every hungry heart by the authority of your word. Jesus. Whew. Yes, yeah. Touch that beautiful blonde lady beside you, sis, and let her know I'm speaking to her. I'm rebuking the hopelessness that has come to you. I'm rebuking that spirit of depression that's trying to steal from you. God has a word for you. He's got a purpose for you. If you just have faith to believe and receive, He's going to bless you with peace and joy in the house today, and a hope will arise in you. Some of you are speaking in the spirit, but if you're not speaking in the spirit, go ahead and speak it in the flesh. Declare life. Speak life to your body. Speak life to your family. Speak life to your loved one. You shall live. You shall live. Speak life to this church. Speak life to the promise. Speak life to the prophecy. We are in revival. Speak life to the finances. We are blessed. We are blessed. Speak life to the finance. Speak life to your finance. Speak life to the church's finance. I speak life in Jesus' name. I need to do one last thing. I need to do one last thing. I believe that there's a ministry of impartation concerning resurrection in life that is trying to happen. Touch her, let her know I'm speaking to her. There's a ministry of impartation of life and resurrection that is trying to happen on key members of this church. And that you will speak this in the days to come and remind us God has promised us life. That you will pray this in the days to come and God will use you in a powerful victory as you speak life and pray life and declare life and worship life and praise in life. If you want that ministry, lift your hands and let me pray for you right now. As I pray this prayer, I'm turning the ministry loose. I'm turning the pulpit over to pastor. I'll operate in the altars. But let's let God have his way right now. Lift up your hands for impartation. By the authority of the word of God. And the power of the name of Jesus. In that you have sent your servant here tonight to declare this. I speak impartation of ministry and spiritual authority. You can speak life and watch resurrection. Receive it in Jesus' name. Yeah, receive it in Jesus' name. Receive it.
Begin to speak life. I want you to begin to speak blessing. I want you to speak healing. Begin to lay hands on those around and speak healing. Speak faith. Speak with authority. It's not in our power, it's in God's power.
Report of the Lord. Whose report will you believe? His report. His report says I am healed. His report says I am filled. His report says I am free. His report says victory. Whose report will you believe? shall believe the report of the Lord. Whose report will you believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. Whose report, his report, will you believe? We shall believe the report of the Lord. Whose report will you believe? We shall believe his report. His report says I am.
I want you to know that I win. Ooh, no matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win.
No matter what the weapon, no matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. No matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. No matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. Ooh, I win, 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 I win. No matter, no matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. Ooh, no matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. The weapon is, I want you to know that I win. No matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. Oh, I win, I win, I win, I win. I'm on the winning side, I'm on the winning side. I win, I win. In Jesus' name, I'm gonna win. Hey, I'm gonna win. I want you to know that I win. Oh, no matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. No matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. Oh, no matter what the weapon is, I want you to know that I win. Hey, oh, I win, I win, I win, I win, I win, I win. I win, I win. I'm on the winning side, the winning side. We're gonna win, we'll win. I win, I win, I win, I win. In Jesus' name, I win, I win, I win. In Jesus' name, we're gonna win. By the power of the blood, we're gonna win.